I want to emphasize that this is supposed to be a nutrition 101. It's like the basics. How do I get started? Why do we even have a conversation about nutrition, especially as it relates to CrossFit when CrossFit is a strength and conditioning program? So we're gonna start from kind of that platform. You can nerd out on nutrition a ton. That's not the goal of this, but I'm happy to talk to any of you guys that want to nerd out on it, like after the course, after this talk and discussion. So I do want it to be pretty casual. So when you have questions, please ask them. I don't want to just stand up here and talk at you for like 40 minutes. So nutrition 101. So kind of why are we even having this discussion? I think all of you guys work for CrossFit. So raise your hand if you have read What is Fitness, the article that Greg wrote. Okay, if you haven't, pull it up online, read it. If it's been a long time since you've read it, go back and read it. He wrote that, I believe, in 2002. And there's this theoretical hierarchy in the development of an athlete. It looks like a pyramid. You've probably seen it in like an L1 guide or in that article. Do you guys know what the base of that pyramid is? I should have tested the marker. Let's try this one. That was a rookie mistake right there. Nutrition, yeah. So the pyramid has 5 levels. The base of it is nutrition. Do you guys know what comes above that? I know some of you do. Matt Loden?
Metabolic.
Thank you, sir. You didn't think it would be a quiz. Okay, above so metabolic conditioning, your conditioning above that. Go ahead, seminar staff people, thank you. Gymnastics, they have to lecture on it. Above that, yep, and growing. And the top is sport, totally. S-P-O-R-T, cool. I always was tripped up by throwing, like for a really long time. I was like, why the heck do they put weightlifting in throwing? But they're both quarter extremity movement patterns. They're both you controlling an external object. If you watch the games, 2011, Jason Kalipa looked like a crazy person, like trying to throw a ball. It didn't look quite right. And you're like, how are you so freaking fit, but you can't throw a ball? You know, it's crazy. Anyway, I digress. So nutrition is the base of this pyramid. So really, when we think about this, like in our training, this should be the first thing that we focus on. A lot of us kind of mix these layers up and we're like, oh, but I want to do that really cool gymnastic stuff before you have like a metabolic or you have a conditioning base. So ideally you get your nutrition in line first, but a lot of us work out first and then we circle back to nutrition. So we're going to focus on that. Nutrition is cool because it's something that you control 100%. I always think of it like, yeah, we come to class, we work out for an hour a day. So we're like getting our fitness in and we take that really seriously, but you can mess all of that up really easily in the other 23 hours of your day. So this is something that really needs to be the forefront of our mind, not in an obsessive kind of way, but it becomes a lifestyle and it becomes a habit, the same way going to class every day at noon or whatever your habit is with regards to your fitness. Your nutrition can kind of follow that path. It'll support kind of whatever health and performance goals that you guys have. Now we are gonna get a little science-y just because I want you guys to have kind of a fundamental understanding of how kind of, how food affects us, why we talk about certain things. You'll hear, I know, off the carbs, off the couch, and we talk a lot about type 2 diabetes, we talk about chronic disease, how does all that interplay? So the main currency of energy that we're gonna talk about for most of us is glucose or blood sugar. So when you guys eat, your blood sugar levels are going to raise. It's a normal physiological reaction. Now, glucose or blood sugar, it provides immediate energy to you in the form of ATP for things like your brain and your muscles, things that you need to survive, that need to function. It'll also provide short-term energy stores in the form of glycogen. So like a lot of times you'll hear like, I gotta replenish my glycogen reserves like after you've worked out, for things like the liver and the muscles. So your short-term energy stores is glycogen. I promise the science-y part won't last too long. And then long-term energy stores in adipose tissue or as fat. No. Your body will do everything in its power to control your blood sugar levels. Because if they go too high or they go too low, there can be serious implications, not only just on your health, but ultimately on your survival. And there's two hormones, one of which I'm pretty sure all of you have heard of, that work together to control your blood sugar. So one is insulin, and the other is glucagon. So when you eat and your blood sugar goes up, insulin's released by your pancreas. And we think about insulin as our storage hormone. So you have like nutrients and stuff floating around in your blood sugar is elevated, and insulin's gonna be like, hey, cells, like pull that out of your blood, and it brings your blood sugar back down to a normalized level. So insulin released by your pancreas, we think of it as our storage hormone. So its job is to reduce your blood sugar and just to bring it back down to normal. And then counter-regulatory to that, so the opposite of that is glucagon, also released by your pancreas. Opposite of insulin, we think of it more as a mobilization hormone. So if your blood sugar then has dropped too low, either because you haven't eaten in a while, you're in a fasted state, or you're consuming a really low carbohydrate or your low carbohydrate intake, it's going to bring your blood sugar back up just to maintain homeostasis. And that's maintain homeostasis, whoop, if things work properly. So this is this finely tuned system. And I think you guys know, like we often ask at the level one, like, okay, think about today's society and like just normal people walking around in the world. Do you think we have more of a problem with storage or mobilization? And I think the answer is like, yeah, storage. So the issue is that we can start to eat in a way where we see hormonal dysregulation, and what tends to happen is that insulin levels creep higher and higher and higher over time. It doesn't happen like with one cheat meal, like just because you ate a donut today, it's like crazy. But over days, weeks, months, years of eating a certain way, we see insulin levels that become chronically high. And there's a name for that condition. It's called hyperinsulinemia. Again, you don't need to know all this to understand where to start with your nutrition. But when you hear Greg and you hear CrossFit and a lot of the media that we're putting out, trying to reverse chronic disease and trying to help people that have chronic disease, it's because oftentimes they've eaten in a way that their insulin levels are chronically high, meaning just walking around day to day, every minute of the day, insulin levels are too high. They're higher than they should be. And that condition of hyperinsulinemia is linked to all sorts of chronic diseases that you guys are way too familiar with. So things like type 2 diabetes, of course, is one commonly known. Alzheimer's, cancer, obesity, heart disease, all of these things driven by the way that our standard diet is causing this hormonal dysregulation. So now we circle back to CrossFit. So where the heck do we start with like trying to fix this? And you guys all know it. You guys have a poster. It's really cool. I wish we had one up north. The fitness in 100 words. The very first sentence, what is it? What does it say? Say it out loud. It's a diet prescription. It says, eat meats and vegetables, nuts and seeds, some fruit, little starch, no sugar. That's where we start. That's speaking to ways that we can start to move ourselves away from conditions associated with hyperinsulinemia, to regulate our blood sugar and our hormonal response to the foods that we're eating. So I'm gonna write that list. Are you guys good if I erase this? I'm gonna write that list on the board, because the first thing that I start with when it comes to talking about food is making sure that everybody understands what a macronutrient is, what are the three categories of macronutrients, and then how does that list break down by macronutrients? So let's start there. So the list goes, eat meats and vegetables, nuts and seeds, then what? Some fruit, yep. Some fruit, little starch, and no sugar. Womp, womp. Okay, so let's pause for a second on macronutrients. What are the three categories of macronutrients? Yep, you got it. Protein, carbohydrates, and fat. Okay. So when we look at protein, carbohydrates, and fat, and you look at meat, what's the predominant macronutrient in meat? Protein. So we'll put a P there. Now, recognizing, of course, that most meat sources are going to contain some fat, but the major one is protein. So we categorize meats as protein. Veggies. What is the predominant macronutrient in vegetables? Carbohydrates. Switch colors. Now, do vegetables have a large carbohydrate load or a lower carbohydrate load? Lower. So basically what that means is you can eat more vegetable than, let's say, something like fruit and get the same amount of carbohydrate. Okay, like if you look at the nutrition facts, like you could eat a shit ton of broccoli versus like a piece of watermelon. Okay, nuts and seeds. What's the predominant macronutrient there? Fat, for sure. Do they have some protein in them? Absolutely. Do they have some carbohydrates in them? Absolutely. Gotta watch that at some point. That was a tough one. I used to like go ham on some almond butter when I first like changed my, I'll get into that in a second. But, and then I was like, why am I gaining weight? I don't understand. It's eating way too much almond butter. Okay, some fruit. Well, what's fruit? Just concentrating on that. What's the predominant macronutrient? Carbs. And again, I already alluded to that. Higher carbohydrate load in fruit. What's starch? Carbs. And then we'll come back to sugar in a second. Now, usually a common question at the L1s, a common question when I gave this talk up north was like, well, okay, well, says some fruit, like how much is that? What does that mean? And when you're looking at this list, where to start with regards to your nutrition, meat, veggies, nuts and seeds, some fruit, little starch, no sugar. When you look at some, just think of some as eating less fruit than you do vegetable. Don't get too worried about it. Just fill your plate with green stuff and cruciferous veggies and spinach and all the things you know are good for you, and then eat less fruit than you do that. Great. And then it says something, little starch. Again, there's a higher carbohydrate load in starches. So when you're talking about little starch, eat less starch than you do of fruit. That's little starch. Easy day. Now, this kind of category of foods, how would you categorize it? What kind of foods are they? Like big picture. Real foods, whole foods, not processed foods. Where do you find them in the grocery store? Perimeter. They often don't have an ingredient list. I'm gonna hit on kind of like paleo and some of the like trendy diet stuff out there right now. And it's like, God, I was walking through Whole Foods yesterday, actually. And it's like, I did go down the packaged food aisle. So I admit that. And all of these bags of like chips and things were like paleo approved. Like the bacon that I buy says paleo approved. And it's like, what the hell does that even mean? So most of the time when you're searching and you're shopping for your foods, look for stuff that doesn't have an ingredient list. Like chicken doesn't have any, it says chicken on it. It's chicken, broccoli, like the produce section. None of that stuff has an ingredient list on it. Pick those things the majority of the time. You're gonna be really well off just doing that, okay? Now this no sugar thing like hangs everybody up, of course. And it means no added sugar, okay? So it's not like, yeah, we understand there are naturally occurring sugars and starches and fruits and vegetables and nuts and seeds. Cool, don't stress about it. No added sugar. And understand too that that doesn't just mean like white table sugar. It's not just like, do you guys go to Starbucks? Every time I go to Starbucks, I see someone pick up that damn thing, like the sugar container, and it's just like, and I'm sorry if any of you guys do this, but I'm like, oh my God, like I have a headache immediately just thinking about that. But it's not just like white sugar that you would think of on your table. It's really anything you're trying to replace your sugar with. When I first started messing around with my diet, paleo was very trendy, as I know it still is. And this was like 2009. And I would do everything in my power to make paleo brownies. I was like, paleo, you name the thing. I would seek out recipes for paleo something. And they had maple syrup in them. They had like Splenda, whatever, you name it. Truvia, Stevia, Splenda, agave nectar, that was a big one. that shit is all interpreted by your body as sugar. Okay, so am I saying you can never have that again? No, I'm not, but I'm saying call a spade a spade. Understand what it is. If you're gonna make paleo brownies, great, but they're still brownies. Okay, it doesn't mean you get to eat the whole pan. You know, I don't know, I did it. So I admit it. So no sugar. So our prescription is not paleo. Paleo leaves out some categories of foods that we say you need to experiment with to figure out whether they belong in your diet or not. Do you guys know what those, there's three major categories of foods, not L1 people, you can't answer. Do you guys know what those foods are, categories? Dairy's one, yep. What else? Yeah, grains in general. There's one more. Yeah, legumes. What are legumes? What the heck are legumes? Do you guys know? Yeah, things that come in pods. So like beans, peanuts, things like that. So grains, legumes, and also dairy. So that's what like a true paleo would be like, none of that. And the reason is that in many people have found that when they eat categories of these foods, they either have an allergic or an autoimmune response. So allergic, you can think about like a seasonal allergy. Like when you eat it, do you feel itchy? Do you get a little bit of a rash? Does your nose run? Does your throat feel scratchy? Maybe like your stomach gets a little bit upset. Autoimmune, certainly much more serious, where your body can't recognize the difference between proteins in some category of foods and its own tissue, and it winds up attacking itself and causing a whole host of health issues. So how do you know? Unfortunately, I usually actually start this off and I didn't today. A lot of people come to these talks because they want to be told exactly what they should eat to achieve this thing. Like, I want to look like that person, or I want to perform like that person, and I can't give you that today. Nobody can really give you that. You have to experiment because it's going to be different for all of us. But what it really tends to come back to, what it always comes back to when we talk about experimentation, is taking, it's an elimination protocol, taking all things that might irritate you, that might not sit well with you, taking all of them out of your diet for a reset period. It's got to be a few weeks, like 3 to 4 weeks. And then one at a time, whatever one you miss most, add it back in. And you make an evaluation on yourself. So the evaluation can look something like, how do I look? Like, what's my body composition look like? Am I happy with it? How do I feel? I always put an asterisk here so I don't forget to come back to it. But what are your energy levels like? How are you sleeping? How do you feel in your workouts? What's your performance like in the gym? How do you feel? Are you watching any of your health markers? And if you are, is there an effect on your health markers? And certainly performance, and that kind of does tap into feel, but performance is certainly something more quantifiable, right? Like, are your numbers slipping in benchmark workouts that you're repeating? Are you not lifting as much as you once were? So let's say you've taken all of these out and you're like, God, I really miss cheese. That's like a thing. I know that I can't eat dairy. I've known that since I was a child. So I can't relate to those of you that are like, but I could never give up cheese. But it seems to be one that people are always like, I miss cheese so much. So let's say you take it all out, you add back in cheese, and you make this, you go through this checklist and you're like, how do I look? Well, you know, my body composition's where I want it to be. My health markers are where I want them to be. I feel good in the gym. My performance and my workouts is awesome. But all of a sudden I'm like, my stomach's really upset, or wow, I feel like I can't breathe through my nose, like so I'm really stuffy. Then you are having a reaction to dairy. But then you have that data and you can make that decision for yourself. Are these symptoms that I'm experiencing, is it worth it? Do I love cheese that much that I'm willing to put up with like a little bit of a stuffy nose sometimes? Or maybe it becomes a cheat. You're like, that's the thing I'm gonna have, but I know I'm gonna suffer for it. And maybe that's what happens to you with grains. Maybe that's what happens to you with legumes. I can't tell you that until you try it for yourself. Has anyone done this? Has anyone like tried taking stuff out and adding it back in? Did you guys have any like eye-opening moments? What were the things that got you? Shout them out. Yeah, same. Exactly. No, I have no issue with legumes. No problems whatsoever. But grains and dairy, anybody else? Same idea, basically. What happens? Bloated. Yep, same. Congestion. Yep.
Right there.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, cold stomach.
Sometimes it's worth it, but you know what's going to happen. I was lamenting at dinner last night that I have a serious reaction to gluten in particular, but grains and gluten. My personal story, which I'll share briefly, because maybe some of you relate, is that up until I really tried this, like I truly took all this stuff out of my diet and was like clean, removal for 30 days, and then added in one at a time, I just thought it was normal to like have an upset stomach every single time I ate. And I would bet you money that both my parents have some sort of intolerance to something here that they've never given up, because in our family, it was just like, oh yeah, the Polaskis, we just have upset stomachs. It's just what we have. Because my mom's the same way. My dad is the same way. My brother is the same way. And when I did it, when I took it out, I didn't notice it at the time because that was my normal. Like I wasn't all of a sudden like, oh wow, like my stomach's not that upset. It was when I added it back in. The thing I missed most was carrot cake. I love carrot cake, straight up. Yeah, I mean, it's delicious. So if you don't like carrot cake, there's the door. But I added carrot cake back in and I was like, holy shit, literal. Like, this is not okay. To the point, like I already told you guys, like I won't even have a cheat. My boyfriend, God love him, like he's found a gluten-free carrot cake that he makes on my birthday because I'll eat that. But you won't know until you try it. So our recommendation is remove them, add them in one at a time, figure it out for yourself what works and what doesn't. And this is kind of the metric for any questions that you guys have with regards to your diet. Like, should I take a pre-workout shake? Should I have a post-workout shake? Should I consume more carbohydrates at certain times during the day or on my rest day or not? And it's like, freaking try it. Like, experiment with all that. Pardon my language. Experiment with all that shit. If you're into it, do it. But be realistic about whether it's working for you or it's not. Okay. Are there any questions on this? This is kind of our starting spot. This is quality. We want you to eat most of the time quality foods, real foods, non-processed foods, and in quantities that kind of line up like this. Less fruit than you do veggie, less starch than you do fruit. Don't add sugar to your food. No questions on that. Okay, awesome. The next step kind of takes this, so we're not throwing out quality food. We still want you to eat quality food, but it starts to talk more about quantity. And quantity is one of those things that I know people are like, oh my God, like that really trips me out. I don't have a clue where to start. I don't know how to do it. But if you're talking about optimizing your health and certainly your performance, you need to figure out how much food you need to eat in a day so that you are eating an appropriate amount, at least enough, which is an issue for some people that I can't relate to, or not too much. So you need to be in this kind of bandwidth of what your body needs to sustain itself and your activity. Now, at the level one, we talk about the zone. Have you guys all heard of the zone diet? Is there anyone that has not? Because I'm going to go into it a little bit. I'm not going to go down a rabbit hole with it. So if you have more in-depth questions, we can talk afterwards. But there are a million ways to quantify your food. If you've been around CrossFit, like people are into macros. There's so many apps out there that you can kind of like track your macronutrients, how much you're eating. The zone was developed like pre all these really cool apps. And so I printed out a couple of them, but like I'm old school, I'm gonna admit it. I do use an app now, but only within the last year have I started using an app to track my food. I am very much like, this is laminated and it is on my refrigerator. And this is what I reference when I make my meals. So I printed these out. I'll give them to you if you want. But it's a zone chart. It tells you how much of each food you should eat to hit a certain number of grams of each macronutrient. If I just lost you, don't worry. I'm going to take a step back. So the goal is, after we eat meats and veggies, nuts and seeds, some fruit, little starch, and no sugar, the next sentence actually speaks to quantity. It says, keep intake to levels that will support your exercise, but not your body fat. And that's what I mean when I say we need to be eating at least enough, but not too much. So we need to find what that bandwidth is. So we're gonna talk about quantifying. Now, when we talk about quantifying, we're looking for, dang it, I just need to get rid of that one. I keep trying to pick it up. Okay, enough food that will support your lean body mass. So that's just your fat-free mass and your activity. Okay, what's your energy expenditure during the day? Now, when we talk about the zone breaks food down into this unit of measure called a block. How many of you guys have heard that before? If you've been around, you've heard that one. Okay, so we've got a block of food, and it takes these macronutrients, and it just says one block has X number of grams of protein, carbohydrate, and fat. Those numbers are, one block has 7 grams of protein, 9 grams of carbohydrate, and 3 grams of fat. Now, if you guys care, we don't, if you've been around CrossFit, we don't stress much about calories. Like, we're not like counting calories in, calories out, because it's pretty imprecise and really not useful when it comes to it, because we care a lot about the macronutrient balance. But if you break this down, this would be 30% of your calories coming from protein, 40% of your calories coming from carbohydrate, and then 30% coming from fat. So sometimes you hear like a 30-40-30 breakdown. That's where that comes from. Now, the zone would take this information, your lean body mass and your activity level, and it would come up with a number of blocks that you need to eat in a day in order to support those things. There is a mathematical equation that you can do to figure out your baseline block prescription. I will give it to you, but then I will give you a really easy way, because the goal is just to start. So the mathematical equation is your lean body, let me take it back, I'll take it even simpler. For a normal CrossFitter, it is 10% of your lean body mass. So I'll use myself as an example. If you're working out once a day, 5 days a week, I weigh 140 pounds. I shouldn't have used myself. The math is gonna be too difficult. I'm not gonna use myself. Let's take a 200 pound athlete that is 10% body fat. So they have 20 pounds, 10% of 200, that is not their lean body mass. That is their fat mass. So we would take 200 minus 20 is 180. You guys with me so far? Okay. And then we take 10% of that, so divided by 10 is 18. So that would be their baseline block prescription. They would eat 18 of these during the day. If you don't want to do the math, there is a handy dandy chart in the level one training guide. Do you guys remember the page number? Because I don't remember anymore. Thank you. Haven't been working very much. Page 56 in the level one training guide. You can just Google that and it will pop up. And it has a chart, and it says male or female, and it says a size, small, medium, large, extra large, well muscled. This is my favorite joke that ever that I've stolen from someone on seminar stuff, I don't even know who. And inevitably someone's like, but what size am I? I don't know. Am I a small, am I a medium, am I a large? And it's really simple. You go, I'm a male or female, figure that out. So I go, I'm a female, I wear a medium t-shirt, I am a medium female. That's where you start. Because here's the reality. How many of you have zoned? I know some of you guys have. Did any of you stay at your baseline block prescription forever? Not even close. So it is just a starting point for you to now have data and quantities on what you're actually eating in a day. You do that for a few weeks, and then you go back here and you go, huh, I have potentially, most people lean out on the zone because it's feeding your fat-free mass. what happened to me personally, and I see some nods, so to some other people, is I was happy with how I looked, but when I went to like my performance and how I felt in my workouts, I felt like shit. Like I was not taking in enough energy to support my activity level. So after 4 weeks, I was like, all right, and we made an adjustment, but you have data. So adjustments will happen. So just pick one and start. Okay. Do you want me to go in? I'm gonna do it. Let's go into like how we build a meal using blocks. Because I think that can be a confusing piece for people. Are you guys good on how you can determine your starting point? How many blocks in a day? Block is gonna have protein, carbohydrates, and fat in it. It needs to have all three macronutrients in that meal. So we could take this 18 blocks, and let's say that this person wants to have a 4-block breakfast. Basically, what they're gonna do is they need to get to 18 total blocks for the day. So if they eat 4 blocks at breakfast, let's say they also eat 4 blocks at lunch. Maybe they like to have a little bit bigger dinner. So that's 8, so what do we have? We have 9, 13 blocks. So we still have 5 blocks during the day to play with. Those can be thrown in as snacks somewhere. So maybe they like to have a 2-block snack there, maybe a 2-block snack here, and then maybe a 1-block snack before dinner. And you can really split that up however you want, as long as you get to your total throughout the day. Does that make sense? There's a couple little rules in there, like try not to go more than 5 hours in between your meals. And then the big kicker, sorry, but you don't get more than 5 blocks in a single meal. That's your upper limit. So you can't just like save them all up and be like, I'm gonna go ham tonight. 10-block dinner. I've done it, but it's not per the zone parameters. Okay, so don't do that all the time. All right, so if we're gonna build, let's say this 4-block breakfast, and we look at this chart, it breaks things down into proteins, fats, and carbohydrates. And it has like pretty much, I mean, there's very few things that I haven't been able to find on this list. And if you can't find them, you can just Google it and you'll figure out how much. So we need to have 4 blocks of protein. We need to have 4 blocks of carbohydrates. And we also need to have 4 blocks of fat to make this 4-block breakfast. So eggs. Eggs for breakfast? Why not? Does anyone know how many eggs is 1 block of protein? 1 whole egg. So in my 4-block breakfast, I would eat 4 eggs. Can you mix it up and have 2 eggs and then 2 blocks of some other protein? Absolutely. If you're like, I want to have chicken and I want to have eggs. Great. Split it up. Everything on this chart equals 1 block. So you just find it. You get to 4 total for your protein. Good on that so far? Okay. Carbohydrates. A simple one is an apple. Half an apple is equal to 1 block. Again, it's on the chart, so you don't need to memorize that. So if I only want apples as my carbohydrates, how many apples do I eat? 2. Do you guys get that math? Half an apple is 1 block. We need 4 blocks. We have 2 apples. 2 apples. Again, can you mix it up? Sure, you absolutely can. Does that seem like a lot to anyone? Yeah, hell yeah, it does. So the zone can be great, or any sort of quantification can be great, because if you're a person that likes quantity, as I am, and I know Mo is, or at least you can handle it, I'm like, I could eat, I don't even know, I know it in grams, so let me look. How many cups of broccoli is 1 block? What is it? I know the grams, but so 1¼ cups of broccoli is 1 block. So you would have to eat 5 cups of broccoli with this breakfast. So if you're someone that's like, I like to eat a lot of food and sit at my table for a long time, which sometimes I am, I go that route. And then sometimes when you're like, I have 10 minutes to eat this meal and get it ready, then you choose something that's a more dense carbohydrate source, like a sweet potato or perhaps some rice if that doesn't bother you. and then you just get a little teeny bit, and it's really sad to me, but some people like that, okay? You can get there however you want, quite flexible. Fat, this one's just funny. Macadamia nuts, anybody know how many? Yeah, we all know. One macadamia nut is one block of fat. So you get four teensy little macadamia nuts, if that's what you choose. But if you choose an avocado, you get four tablespoons of avocado. So you can make your choice there. Let's go. Four shitty little mac nuts. Sad face. Okay. Are there questions on how we built that meal? Okay. If you are interested in attempting the zone, I highly recommend that you print this out and keep it at your house. And what you'll find is that most people are as boring as me, even if they don't admit it, and you eat the same shit every day for the most part. So real quick, you'll learn exactly what your four block breakfast needs to look like. Now, this would be typically a dude, obviously, if we're going with 10% body fat at 200 pounds. So ladies, sorry, generally, my block prescription was 11 the last that I did it. So, but you can do your math and you figure out where you stand. Cool. What are some other quantification? I know there's a bunch of stuff out there. Has anybody tried anything other than zone? What have you guys tried? Okay, RP, yep. Any others? Macro counting, yep. I did macros for 200 days just because I was like, I want to see what this is like. I've never done RP, but I know a lot of people that really like it. I'm just more like, that's just RP for those that don't know. Just kind of, correct me if I'm wrong, actually, but kind of like goes even more into like timing of when you're eating and quantities based on activity level. Here's the deal. There's so many things out there. If you guys are coming from like, I don't do anything with my diet, start here. Start with trying to just improve the quality of what you're eating and sticking to the parameters, the general guidelines on quantity built into this prescription. If you can go there, like shit, you're doing freaking awesome. And then when you stop seeing results from that, I saw a ton of results for this for a long time. And then when I stopped, I was like, all right, we got to start thinking about something else. And that's when it started to be like, somehow I need to quantify what I'm eating because clearly I'm making a mistake somewhere with regards to how much of the macronutrients or the balance in my meals. So then you can start delving into quantifying. What are things you need to quantify? Who's done it? You need to buy a couple things. You definitely need a food scale. The cool thing about working here is we've got one in the break room. You can get them for like 10 bucks on Amazon. Need a food scale, what else? Yeah, you probably need some like measuring cups, measuring spoons, things like that. Really, that's it. That's really it. And it's, at least I think a lot of you guys could probably speak to this if you've done it. It's literally one extra step. Like you're cooking your chicken or whatever, and instead of like going from the pan to your plate to your mouth, just stick your pan on the scale, weigh the amount of chicken that you need. If you need to trim a little off, put it off to the side. If you need a little extra, add it, and then stick it in your mouth. It's one extra step. Cool. Questions? Not a damn thing, really. Is anyone quantifying stuff right now? Yeah? Is anybody zoning? No? I told you, I'm old school, man. Old school, the zone. ZR zoning? Yeah, you're old school like me though. The big thing, the big takeaway, try it. If it doesn't work, toss it out. It's just like working out, you know? It's like we keep our data on our workouts. Like we wanna know how much we've lifted. We wanna know what our times were on our workouts. This is the exact same thing when it comes to your nutrition. If you don't have the data and something's not working, you don't know what to tweak. You don't know what to tweak.